afternoon. Good afternoon. Welcome. Welcome, everyone, to our last World Affairs luncheon of the semester. And thank you for all coming here for a very special time. Before I formally introduce our speaker today, I'd like to call on David Bolzoni. He's the business administrator of the City of Scranton, who brings greetings from Mayor Courtright.
Dottore Orlando, buongiorno e piacere, benvenuto a Scranton. Mi dispiace, parlo un po' italiano. My Italian is about as bad as my English, so I'm going to read this off in English. Welcome. On behalf of the City of Scranton, I would like to offer you a warm welcome to our friendly city. It is an honor and a privilege to have you, the mayor of Palermo, Sicily, visit the City of Scranton. During your stay, may you enjoy the hospitality of our people and our pride. May the warm glow of our friendship accompany you wherever you go, and may you return again soon to the grace of our proud city.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm not sure I can do justice to introducing a legend to you this afternoon. Words can barely express my admiration for this man, whose courage and commitment belie the caricatured image of public officials that have been in all too many cases true to reality. Leoluca Orlando, the former and present mayor of Palermo, and perhaps a future mayor, has relentlessly fought to wrest his beloved city from the clutches of the mafia and return it to its rightful owners, its citizens. His work has succeeded, but as we know, such victories are not permanent. They are works in progress. And so he has returned to the mayoral office twice to continue the struggle. Mayor, or maybe more than twice. Maybe Mayor Orlando understands better than anyone I know the destructive powers of corruption. We see it around the world, killing progress and going deeper than that, killing hope and, of course, murdering innocence. As a lawyer with a background in philosophy, Mayor Orlando has a special wisdom about just how essential it is to be a person's and a community's well-being to get rid of corruption. I sometimes call corruption a weapon of mass destruction, and I don't mean it metaphorically. It does destroy. So Mayor Orlando's war is a just war, clear and simple. He's more like a surgeon removing a cancer. He will tell us in his own vivid language how necessary his task is in the name of decency and dignity. He will remind us that nations and cities belong to their citizens, and while that empowers citizens to live freely and creatively, it also gives them the burden of responsibility for the public good, which I consider to be the most precious right a citizen can have. Let us welcome Mayor Orlando to the podium to speak on identity, the struggle, and the struggle between the culture of human rights and the mafia.
Grazie, buongiorno. Io so che se parlo italiano mi capita lo stesso, but don't worry, I will speak English. I wish to say thanks for this invitation. I wish to say thanks to Sandra Myers, to all of you. Say thanks for continue our experience passing through Palermo. I will never forget the important days we spent together in Palermo, with General Secretary of United Nations Kofi Annan, with Senator Hillary Clinton and Chelsea, with the staff of Senator Orinacci. I mean, it was really, really interesting experience that we lived together, and it's for me a privilege to come back to Pennsylvania. I am not perfect. I've never been in Scranton. It is the first time that I come. I've been several times in Pittsburgh, in Philadelphia, but never in Scranton, so it's a privilege to be here. And therefore, I wish to say thanks to the mayor of the city, for this document that I hope to be able to show him in this city hall in Palermo, where, of course, I will keep waiting for your visit in our city. I, this morning, have to speak about identity, about human rights, about mafia. You know that identity is a really controversial word. I think that the history of the humanity, on behalf of identity, we have seen so terrible crimes. Too many times, humanity has killed the name of identity. But identity is important. Probably the most important thing I have is my identity. It's who I am and who I decide to be. So, to communicate my ideas about identity, I wish just to tell stories, because I think that we normally communicate using words. The words are all dead, are all perfect, are all the same. The stories are all different, are all not perfect, living. So I will tell you some living stories about identity. Speaking about my experience just arriving, somebody says, oh, Mr. Mayo, you have really a great experience. I say, yes, I have a tremendous experience. I have a really great experience. George Bernard Shaw said that experience is the name we give to our mistakes. So I have a great experience. Because I did a lot of mistakes. And speaking about my mistakes, and speaking about my stories, somebody asked, why are you so strongly engaged against the mafia? And I have to say that my engagement against the mafia started from two questions. Two questions changed deeply my life. I studied in the school, in a Jesuit school, in a Jesuit school in Palermo. And I was 14 years old, when I organized with other students a seminar about the mafia and against the mafia. It was something like a scandal. The director of the school, a Jesuit, a very nice guy, a very nice man, a honest man, not a mafioso, protested and called my parents and said to my parents, why Lucchetto, Lucchetto is the little Luca, why Lucchetto speaks about the mafia? We have nothing to do with the mafia, therefore we have not to speak about the mafia. Not seeing, not speaking, not hearing. It was Sicily when I was 14 years old. Almost nobody used the word mafia. You know that the mafia needs 100, 1,000 persons using weapons, killers. But first of all, mafia needs millions and millions of people not seeing, not speaking, not hearing. If they are honest men, as was honest director of the Jesuit College in Palermo, they are the best allied of mafia bosses, because they are honest. And they become an example to the people, inviting them not to see, not to speak, not to hear. It was a situation in Sicily when I was 14 years old. When I was 20 years old, I went to Germany. I went to study in a German university in Heidelberg, just to study law, but my love was philosophy, so I studied in the meantime, the same time, law and philosophy. Imagine that my professors were Martin Heidegger and Sergio Gadamer. They were my professor. I cannot say that I was their student. They would not accept me. Anyway, they were my professor. And when I arrived to Heidelberg, my German friend asked me, where are you coming from? And I replied, from Italy. Where are you coming from? From South Italy. Where are you coming from? From Sicily, Mafia. It was a great contradiction. Almost nobody used that word, the word Mafia, when I was a young boy. But Mafia, Sicily was in the world known only through the Mafia. I had to solve this contradiction. I could say, yes, I was born in Sicily, but I have nothing to do with Sicilian tradition, nothing to do with Sicilian culture, nothing to do with Sicilian identity. Or I could say, as I said, I am proud to be Sicilian. In name of the pride of Miss Sicilian, I had to fight against the Sicilian, perverting our identity, becoming Mafia boss. So my fight against the Mafia is in name of my pride to be Sicilian. This question, where I'm coming from, changed deeply my life. A second question changed deeply my life. I got the best diploma at the end of the high school. I was, believe me, I have the proof. I was the best Italian student. I normally translated from Greece into Latin, not passing through Italian language. I was really, really the best. I have a document, I can give proof. And my parents were so proud. Lucchetti is the best Italian student. And they sent me in a prize holiday in London. And I spent 3 months in London. I was in the Tate Gallery because I love it and I love so much Van Gogh paintings in Tate Gallery. And I was in Tate Gallery when a wonderful girl just came to me, a wonderful Sicilian girl that I never met in Sicily. This wonderful girl told me, you are the best Italian student. I've seen your 40 newspapers. You are Leoluca Orlando. Yes, I said, I was so proud. And she was so nice. And after that, she said, I am Sicilian, just like you are. I am 18 years old, just like you are. And I studied. I got my diploma, just in the high school. But I have not correctly understood what Immanuel Kant writes in Critique of Pure Reason. Can you explain just the thought of the philosopher of Königsberg? I spent 2 hours speaking about Kant because I love the philosophy and this girl was wonderful. After 2 hours, I have nothing else to say. I said all what I knew about philosophy. And this girl told me, basta, enough is enough. Now that everything is clear about philosophy, I am a Sicilian girl, and I ask to you, Sicilian boy, what do you do against the Mafia? This young girl has become my wife. So you can understand the role. So you can understand the role of the women in the fight against the Mafia. After so many years, I am controlled at home. When I come back home, my wife will ask, what did you do yesterday in Scranton against the Mafia? I am under control. I am under control. Two questions, where are you coming from? And the other question, what do you do against the Mafia has changed my life more than 100 speeches of important and wise person. Because I wish to introduce me, just telling the stories. May I introduce me My first name is Leoluca. Leoluca is not Saint Luca Evangelist. Leoluca is the name of the Saint Patron of Corleone. Yes? You have correctly heard. Who is named Leoluca sure comes from Corleone. My grandfather was born in the city hall in Corleone. That was the aristocratic palace of my family in Corleone. So when I go in Corleone and I say that I am against the Mafia, you can understand what a kind of explosion is. They cannot say, it comes from Berlin, it comes from Stockholm, it comes from Milan. No, I come from Corleone. And when I am in Corleone, I don't say only the Totori, Ino, Bernardo Provenzano, criminal mafia boss are criminals. Everybody knows they are criminals. Even they know to be criminals. I say they are not worthy to be Corleonese. They are not worthy to be Sicilian. They cannot use Sicilian identity just to defend their crimes. Leoluca is my first name. My family name is Orlando. It's a very, very common family name in South Italy. And I was born in Palermo, so probably you have understood that I am Sicilian. What can I do? I have shame or try to be proud for my identity. I decided to be proud for my identity. And in name of my pride to fight against the criminals using and perverting my identity to kill. So I think that I can speak about the Mafia. Please don't forget, the Mafia is no normal criminality. Excuse me for using the word normal. Normal criminality is against the state and outside the state. Against the banks and outside the banks, against the church and outside the church, against civil society and outside civil society. This is a normal criminality. The Mafia is something more and something else. The Mafia is against and inside the state, against and inside the banks, against and inside the church, against and inside civil society. The Mafia needs to be inside. When the Mafia is no longer inside, is no longer Mafia. Becomes normal criminality. Therefore, when we speak about normal criminals, we don't need the geographic adjective. A robber is a robber. We don't say Swedish robber, Spanish robber, Sicilian robber, an American robber. A robber is a robber. Is a normal criminal. Is a normal criminal against. Against the state, against the bank, against the church, against civil society. The Mafia does not exist. The Mafia without an adjective does not exist. The Mafia needs to be Sicilian in Sicily, Russian in Russia, Chinese in China, Japanese in Japan. The Mafia needs to be inside. Therefore, the Mafia needs to have the face of Sicilian in Sicily. The face of Russian in Russia, the face of Chinese in China, the face of Japanese in Japan, the face of Colombian in Colombia. The Mafia needs to have the face of the people, because the Mafia is not normal criminality. The Mafia is a system of power, a system of cultural power, a system of political power, a system of financial power. I forgot. It's a system of criminal power. I forgot. It's a criminal. A mafia boss is no serial killer. The dream of a mafia boss is never to die, to kill. The dream of a mafia boss is never to kill. It doesn't mean that he does control everything. Because the killings is the proof there is a contrast between the different mafia clans or between the Mafia and the state. Corleone, 27 years long, 1947. Here, Salon was the safest city in the world. For 27 years, there was no robbery in Corleone. Statistically, was the safest city. Democratically, was a city under total control of mafia bosses. In Corleone, for many years, the robbers were not free to rob. I give you an important communication. In Palermo, we have a lot of robberies today. Oh, we won, finally. Finally. We are, because the mafia is a system of power, it's not normal criminality. So when people say, there was a robbery in Palermo, and the mayor said, I'm so lucky. Because I am afraid that everything is controlled by the system of power of mafia bosses. And the mafia needs a system of values. The mafia needs to pervert a system of values. Just starting from Sicilian mafia, the Sicilian values, the traditional Sicilian values are family, friendship, honor, and religious faith. The mafia boss, they pervert Sicilian traditional values. They kill in name of family, they kill in name of friendship, they kill in name of honor, they kill in name of Catholic faith. When a mafia boss is arrested, normally he has the pitch of a saint. Yes, because he needs to pervert our religious faith. And normally says, I am a man of honor, because for us, honor is important. And normally say, I love family, because for us, family is important. And they say, I love my friends, because friendship is important for us. May I believe in God. May I be a man of honor. May I be a man loving the family and the friends, not being a mafioso? May I be proud to be Sicilian, not perverting my identity? So the mafia needs an adjective because needs to pervert an identity. Sicilian, Russian, Chinese, Japanese, and so on. I am speaking about something that is no longer something that happens in the periphery of the empire. Just in my life, just going all around the world as advisor of different international organizations, I explained the story of Palermo. I spoke about my experience. And I discovered that each culture, each identity is exposed to the risk that I call identity-based criminality. Sicilian mafia is Sicilian identity based criminality. Russian mafia is Russian identity based criminality. Chinese mafia is Chinese identity based criminality. I'm speaking only about the mafia. Let's speak about Islamic terrorism. I love Islamic culture. I have a great respect for Quran. I have a great respect for Prophet. I have a great respect for Allah. The Islamic terrorists, they kill in name of Prophet. They kill in name of Allah. They kill in name of Quran. Who is the first enemy of Islamic culture? The first enemy of Islamic culture is Osama bin Laden, who says that he does defend the Islamic culture. Just like Sicilian mafia, both they say, we are the pure Sicilian. We defend our identity. You are criminals. You are twice criminals because you kill twice. One time you kill person, one time to kill an identity. I love Germany. German language is my second language. Anyway, my first is Sicilian. Probably my fourth is Italian, I don't know. I have to check the professor in the university. I love Germany. I studied in Germany. My father studied in Germany too. And the German, they have a value, a traditional value, respect of authority, respect of the law. We in Italy tell a lot of comic stories about German people respecting the law. What did the National Socialism do? Nazism led German people to respect the law, hold the law, even the law against Jewish. Who is the first enemy of German culture? The first enemy of German culture is Adolf Hitler, who said that he wanted to defend the German culture. And we can go ahead. And each country can ask who is the first enemy of his own identity. You don't need to have fear for normal criminals. No problem. Because if against normal criminals, police is enough. We have to have fear for identity-based criminals. And more important is the value in name of which you kill, more dangerous you are. Because if I kill in name of money, I'm not so dangerous if I kill in name of God. If I kill in name of money, I'm not so dangerous if I kill in name of freedom. If I kill in name of money, I'm not so dangerous if I kill in name of family. So more important is the value that I use to justify my crime, more dangerous I am. It is the lesson coming from Sicily, coming from our experience in the fight against mafia, in the fight against identity-based criminals. Police is important, but it's not enough. When somebody comes here inside and tries to do something against us, it should be enough to call police. But if somebody comes and says that he does what he does, in name of God, in name of family, in name of honor, in name of identity, we have not to call police. We have to call a teacher. We have to call a journalist. We have to call a priest. We have to call civil society. In the fight against the mafias, the different forms of the mafia, including Islamic terrorism or Nazism, we need what I call in my books a Sicilian cart. Do you know how is a Sicilian cart? It's a cart with two wheels. One wheel is wheel of law enforcement, made by prosecutors, police, law, prisons. The other wheel is the wheel of culture. This is made by teachers, school, journalists, church, civil society. The two wheels have to march at the same speed. Because if the wheel of law enforcement marches more speed than the other wheel, the cart does go forward, gets ruined. And people will say it was better when it was worse. I am a really close friend of Rudy Giuliani. Rudy Giuliani has done a wonderful work in New York. I remember many times I arrived in New York and I left because it was an awful city. With Rudy Giuliani, it's become a wonderful city. And this speaks about zero tolerance. Zero tolerance. Don't forget, zero tolerance works against normal criminalities. Doesn't work against identity-based criminals. Rudolph Giuliani won in Manhattan, not in New York. Won in Manhattan, where we had only normal criminalities. Excuse me for using normal. I've been several times in Mexico. I've been in Tijuana, in Ciudad Juarez, in Guadalajara, in Monterrey, in Mexico, in the Distrito Federal. How can I fight against the people in Tepito, in Tijuana, only with police? Doesn't work. Doesn't work. Because to arrest a mafioso needs 3 minutes. But to let the son of mafioso to understand that his father was wrong needs probably 10 years. But if we are not able to let the son of mafioso understand that his father is not the right way, we will have another boss, another criminal, another killer. So the second will is important. And the role of the mayor in Palermo was to check the two wills, to let the two wills march at the same speed. And when the speed of law enforcement was too speedy, the will was too speedy, I had just to improve the other will, school, church, civil society, because if we have only the first will, we reach the people will say we have only zero tolerance. They risk the people will say it was better when it was worse. If we have only the second, we risk to organize a wonderful musical concert in honor of some mafia boss. We need both. And this is exactly what we need all over the world. And this is the reason for which I think that what happened in Palermo can be useful in the rest of the world. You have got my book. And in this book, this is one, I have written 8 books in German, not existing in Italian language. 2 in German, existing in Italian language. This one is one of the 8 not existing in Italian language. It's in German, in English, in Spanish, Mexico, and in Spanish by Universidad Católica Pontificia del Perú, in Lima, and the other one in Lebanon, in Beirut, in Arabic language. And the title in German language of this book was born in English, then translated into German by an editor in San Francisco. The title in German edition is Sollte der Nächste sein. That means I had to be the next. Several times I had to be the next. And I tell in this book how many times I had to be the next. One time I had to be the next and I lived 6 months in a military barrack, even in Palermo. My wife with our daughters at home and I in the military barrack in Palermo and in Rome. Other times I say that I had to be the next, and we went with my wife and our daughters for 1 month and a half in Georgia, in Caucasus, protected by former foreign minister Shevardnadze, just defending the life of my daughter, our daughters, and my wife. There is no photo of the mayor of Palermo with the wife. We are married only from 43 years. Only. I just asked to Saint Peter to be declared a saint. After 43 years. But I received back the letter of Saint Peter saying, Mr. Mayor, we are examining your request, but we have to inform you that in the standby list, your wife comes before than you. Anyway, and there's no photo. My daughter's with my wife. My wife lives, of course, people know that I'm married. But we have decided not to give to my wife, to my daughters, a symbolic meaning. To do something against my wife, against my daughter should be nothing, because they do not exist. They have no symbolic meaning. And my wife normally goes and lives in bus, in metro, and she normally speaks against Orlando. She spent his time just speaking against me. And she speaks against Orlando. And when people react and defend me, she comes back home and says, don't worry, you don't need bodyguards, people love you. You can be safe. And one day, she was in the bus, and she was speaking against me, Orlando, Orlando, for the 50th time, mayor of Palermo. Basta, enough is enough. And my wife told me, everybody was defending you. There was one really, really nervous who said, you are a stupid woman. You cannot speak against Orlando. You don't know Orlando. And my wife said, I could not say that I am the wife. I mean, so speaking about the role of civil society, I had to be the next several times. But I will never forget, among the many times, after the killing of Giovanni Falcone and the wife, Francesca Morvillo, the prosecutor in Palermo, killed in 1992, that I married in the city hall in the night of Saturday because it was too dangerous to marry during the day, Giovanni and Francesca, and without champagne, without photo, without friends invited because it was too dangerous to let them know that I was just celebrating the wedding of Giovanni and Francesca. After the killing of Giovanni and Francesca and three bodyguards that had been my bodyguards in the past, and after the killing of Paolo Borsellino and five bodyguards, there was a terrible reaction in Palermo. People said basta, went in the street, just organizing a human chain, just all around the Justice Palace to say we want to no longer live under the control of corrupted politicians and mafia boss. It was a terrible reaction. A newspaper titled an article, "The next will be Orlando." When the women in Palermo read that "The next will be Orlando," they went to the chief of police, and they carried to the chief of police a list of children, their children, with the name, saying our children are ready to stay inside the protected car of Leoluca Orlando. Of course, no child has come inside my protected car, neither my wife, neither my daughters. But these women have said clearly that I was not alone. These ladies, they have understood that the mafia can kill 100 men, 1,000 men. My mafia cannot kill 1,000 and 1,000 women and children. Because mafia is not normal criminality. And mafia needs to have conscience. And the 2 years after, I did not understand why I was in that time obliged just to fly with helicopter, to fly with another name, to change the place where I lived, to let my daughters to go to a little highland in Greece. My wife had 20 keys of apartment all over Italy. Friends of mine sent to me 20 apartments, not used, and saying, in this apartment, your wife can come when she wishes, not telling anything to anyone. And she lived 2 months all around Italy, because she has always refused to be protected by police, because I said, I wish to feel a free woman, the same our daughters. And she changed every night the place, deciding just in the morning where to sleep in the night. And nobody knew, of course, and nobody knew the face of my wife, who used always is her family name, not my family name. And after 2 years, I knew the result of the civil courage of these women and their children. In a process, you can read, Totò Riina, after the killing of Falcone and the killing of Borsellino, just organized the meeting of the boss of the mafia. And they said, The next has to be Orlando. The majority of mafia bosses said no. The majority of mafia bosses say no. They said, have you read the newspaper? The children and the women in Palermo are ready to die with him. We cannot kill Orlando because it should be dangerous for us. I am still living. And I have to say thanks to the women and to the children. To the women and the children, because the mafia boss, they have no fear for the weapons of police. They have no fear for the sentence of the judges. But they have fear of women and children. Without weapons, civil courage. So to fight against identity-based criminality, we need, first of all, civil courage. And we need the civil courage that is made by respect of human rights. I have now to introduce you Palermo and Sicily. When I speak about Palermo, I speak about Sicily. That's, it is the pride of a Palermitan to be, Jamu, the best part of Sicily. Yeah, I'm sorry. I know we are wrong, but we say. We are wrong, but we say. Anyway, and Palermo is a mosaic. And please, try to imagine if I'm speaking about Scranton. Try to imagine. Okay? When I say Palermo, imagine Scranton. Scranton today or Scranton tomorrow. Palermo is no painting. Palermo is mosaic. Palermo is not a painting. Palermo is not a painting. You know, a painting doesn't need a framework. Antonello da Messina, Miro, they don't need a framework. A painting is a painting without framework. But Palermo is not a painting, it's a mosaic. And the mosaic needs a framework. Because a mosaic is made by different pieces of stones of different colors and dimension. If they have no framework, they have no harmony. They are only a list of confused pieces of stones. Palermo is a mosaic. You can imagine we have a piece of a stone, black, white, corrupted, honest, nice, bad, different dimension. You imagine in Palermo we have 140 different nationalities living in Palermo. 140. In Palermo, we speak 100 different foreign languages. 100. But in Palermo, the dog, the cat, and the mouse, they work together. In the other part of the world, the dog is against the cat is against the mouse. In Palermo, they work together. You will never read or hear one single act of intolerance in Palermo. We have other vices, but not intolerance. we are not perfect. We know, no, no. Allah has said that the most terrible vice for human being is perfection. Allah speaks with everybody, except with people who imagine to be perfect. I think that Allah is right. Huh? You will have no God except God, just the same. Perfection is not of this life. But in the past, the framework of this mosaic was aristocratic families and mafia. You have read Il Gatto Pardo, you have read the Leopard. At that time, the mosaic system was controlled by prince, dukes, and mafia. The mafia boss were the servant of the old aristocratic families. They were the bridge between the richness in the country and the palace in the city. After that, The framework was fascism and mafia. After the Second World War, the framework was politics and mafia. When I was elected for the first time mayor of Palermo in 1985, I decided to fight not only against the mafia pieces of stones, but against the framework. Because I am not a prosecutor. I'm not a prosecutor. My role is not to fight against the mafia boss. My role is to let my city to be free from the politician protecting the mafia boss. Of course, supporting the work of prosecutors, supporting the work of the judges. But I cannot be spectator, just say, go ahead. Yes, go ahead. And you, what you do? What is my role? How I role? And I fight against the framework. I supported the prosecutor. I went in front of the court in 1986, for the first time in the history of Palermo, just claiming the restore of damages to the mafia bosses. 487 mafia bosses all there. You can imagine the face when I come inside the aula bunker. The mayor of Palermo. The mayor of Palermo was normally friend of mafia boss. I must be honest. There was one mayor before me that was not friend of mafia boss. I must be honest. He was the mafia boss. Vito Ciancimino. He was in the same time. He was in the same time, mayor and mafia boss. Can you imagine? How can you ask to the people to fight against the mafia when the mayor is the mafia boss? It's a little complicated. And I was against these persons, and everybody said Orlando is a communist. I had never been communist. Nobody's perfect. I've never been communist. Because there was an identification between system of power and mafia. An identification between prime minister and mafia. And I fight against the prime minister. I fight against people like Giulio Andreotti, 7 times prime minister in Italy. An intelligent, a wonderful man, but protecting the mafia. So more dangerous, eh? More dangerous. Because every time I was against him, I had to see, it's very funny. I fight against this guy because he's protecting the system of power, the mafia system of power in Sicily. But at the same time, I am agree with him because he's defend the right of Palestinian people to have a state. So, just the two different faces. And this is the reason for which I think that today, the mosaic Palermo has a wonderful frame. The frame is respect of human rights. To be different, because we are mosaic. To be equal, because we are human beings. So, we think that the best weapon against the mafia is to respect the human rights. Because the respect of human rights is a terrible enemy of the mafia system of culture. And therefore I'm proud to be the mayor of the city where we have a priest, Don Pino Pugliese, who was killed by the mafia. I'm really proud because finally the men of the church have stopped to stay with the mafia against the people for too many years. I'm Catholic. Nobody's perfect, but I'm Catholic. And Catholic faith is the most important thing in my life, okay? Therefore, I cannot accept bishop and cardinals just being friends of mafia bosses. I'm Sicilian, so I cannot accept Sicilian being mafia bosses. If I should be Islamic, I should not accept, of course, Islamic being terrorist. If I should be German, I should not accept German being Nazist. Because before attacking the other identities, I have to ask what my identity does to defend the human rights. So I'm proud. I knew Tom Pino Puyis. I knew. We were really close. Somebody has written, but I don't believe. Somebody has written that he has always voted for me, but I don't believe. Okay? I cannot say because I don't believe. And but I'm in the same way proud as mayor, because we have organized in Palermo the most relevant gay pride in South Europe. Mm-hmm. Gay pride in South Europe. Respect of human rights. Because I will never forget what Bertolt Brecht has written in a wonderful poem. They came to carry away the blacks, but I did not protest. As you know, I am not black. They came to carry away in prison the Jewish. I did not protest. I am not Jewish. They came to bring away, to carry away the Rome. I did not protest. I am not Rome. They came and they carry away the communists. What have to do with communism? I did not protest. They came to carry on the homosexual. I did not protest. As you know, I'm not homosexual. Finally, they came to carry away me. There was nobody protesting to defend me. I think it's the lesson of respect of human rights. And Palermo, that was considered just a negative example for violation of law, now has become a symbol for respect of human rights in name of the fight against the mafia. We wish just to send you a message. I got in the last election 74% of votes. 74. My party coalition, my strong coalition, got 14%. I got 60 points more than my coalition. It was very funny because the day after I was elected, I was in cathedral with the Cardinal Romeo, the Cardinal in Palermo. Since Cardinal Pappalardo, the Cardinal in Sicily, speak against the mafia, I wish to remember. I wish to remember. Since Cardinal Pappalardo, the Cardinal, the Pope, Giovanni Paolo II, the official church speaks another language. And I was in the cathedral the day after I was elected. And the cardinal says, Mayor, you have to say something, you are the new mayor. And I went just to the podium and I said, I am really happy and proud to be mayor of Palermo. And I have a project. My project is to let grow up my party. There was a moment of confusion in the church. And I said, and my party has the name Palermo. And everybody was agree. Everybody was agree. And let me say something that can appear to be a provocation. You know that humanity has no slavery. Slavery. We have spent 1,000 years to have law against slavery. For 1,000 years, the slavery was recognized by the law. I will never forget that very intelligent, important persons were very important person, but were slaves, merchant. I remember a guy called Voltaire. Voltaire has become rich selling and buying slaves. And it was Voltaire, the famous philosopher, because the law said that it was possible to have slaves. We have spent 1,000 years to abolish death penalty. Death penalty. And still we have a lot of states who have death penalty. One of my experiences was to give the honorary citizenship of Palermo to a Cherokee condemned in Virginia to death penalty. And that we have buried this guy in Palermo, from Norfolk, Richmond to Palermo. And that time I had the support of the Pope Johannes Paul II, who told me it is a fight for the life. Nobody can kill. Neither the states. Neither the states. And Vatican abolished the death penalty only in 2001. The next abolition has to be the residence permit. The residence permit. It's not possible that thousands and thousands of people die because they are not free to decide where to live, where to die. It's not possible that we are able to decide. I did not decide where to be born. I don't know if you decide where to be born. My parents did not ask me. So I was born where I was born. The only right I have is to decide where to live, where to decide where to die, to decide where to try to avoid to be killed. And we have introduced the residence permit. I am for the abolition of residence permit, for the abolition. I know that Palermo is too little to abolish the residence permit because everybody can, too many persons will come. Don't forget, I am for the legality, but if one day I will be arrested because at home I have a man who tries to leave this family not having authorization, that decide to violate a law, then to let the family die, if I will be arrested, I will be an happy man, okay? I will respect the statement of the judges, but I will say, I hope that one day we will be free from this illegal, human, illegal law. I know it's complicated, I know. Many objections about that. I got 74% of votes in Palermo just saying what I'm saying now. You understand? How ahead we are in Palermo after the reaction against the mafia. We have been obliged to become better because we have suffered too long. And Sicily, probably, I don't tell you what my wife does with the illegal migrant. You can imagine. Anyway, she knows me, so she does what I should like to do, and I have some problem to do. Sicily is too little. Italy is probably too little. European Union, 28 states, more than 500 million of inhabitants. We are too little to say welcome to everybody. Welcome to everybody. Your country has become what has become without residence permit. Your strength is based just accepting everybody, coming and respecting to be different and to be equal. To be different, to be equal. And every time I have the privilege and the honor to meet the Pope Francis, I have repeated this. So I think that the next time he will say, I know. It was, I wish to tell you my wonderful experience with this wonderful Pope. A Jesuit named Francis. It's wonderful. Because everybody, I speak about my education, my life is between Ignazio and Francis. To have a Jesuit named Francis, I cannot say, it's perfection. It's perfection. Because in one way education, in another way solidarity. And when he was elected, I called all my Jesuit friends, I called all my Franciscan friends, just saying, I'm happy for this Pope. And finally, I tried to call even the Cardinal of Palermo, the Cardinal Romeo. And I called him, but he did not reply. He was inside the conclave, because they remained for some time after the election inside. And I called with the the bishop, the vicario, the bishop, the number two, I mean, that was not in conclave because not cardinal. And I called it Carmelo, is the name Carmelo. Carmelo, I'm so happy. I'm so happy, very important moment for the life of the church. And I said, I am so happy because it was elected mayor. Was elected Pope. You probably understand that I'm just mayo just in my mind. I said, I'm so happy because it was elected Pope, the Cardinal of Palermo. And the Bishop Carmelo, the Vicario of Cardinal Romeo, said, Luca, you are drunk. The Cardinal Palermo elected the Pope. Yes, Palermo is a part of the city of Buenos Aires. So say to the Cardinal, will be the next time. And I have met, the first time I met because the Pope received the former student of Jesuit College. And Father Lombardi said that I was the best in the history of Jesuit in Italy. So I went there as the best former student that I got last year my diploma. Just last year. And I said to the Vatican, Pope Francis, thanks, because with your election, whoever felt, whoever heard the poor hail of church after so many bad hail of Vatican, he embraced me. I don't tell you the faces of the two cardinals by the Pope. I don't think that they approved my idea, because I think that this Pope will be able to destroy finally Vatican, in name of church, of course, in name of church. And the second time, it was 1 month ago, we spoke about migration. And then I said to the Pope, Pope Francis, next week my wife will be operated in an hospital in Lyon, in France, where my wife stays from 3 months. Will be operated next week, my wife. And the Pope asked me, tell me the name of your wife, Maria Rosario. Tomorrow the Pope will pray for Maria Rosario. Wow. So I think that you probably have understood how important is the faith for me. But I believe in God, in one God. Don't ask me the right name of God. I don't know. So when I come inside a mosque, I pray Allah. When I come inside a synagogue, I pray Yahweh. When I meet the Dalai Lama, I speak about Buddha. So when I will die, I hope to be able to say to God, I prayed even for you. Because at the moment I'm Catholic. But so it is my insurance contract. And one day I was just saying that to a cardinal, a friend of mine, said, imagine if we discover that our God is not the super God, the right one. And he told me, and you protest? You are a civil man. Nobody knows that you are Catholic. Imagine me, so dressed that after all my life I discovered that I was dressed in the name of another God, not the right one. So somebody goes to God passing through Allah Boulevard, somebody passing through Jesus Christ Place, somebody along Yahweh Street, and somebody can reach God through the difficult path of the reason. But if God is one, is one. And I think that only in Palermo today is it possible to speak as I speak and to receive 74% of votes of population. Thanks a lot. I'm sorry, but you have the best proof that I am Sicilian. People normally say Sicilians don't speak. Wrong, we speak so much. Omerta, silence, law, all wrong. Questions?
Well, first I want to thank the mayor. No. I think that he got more than 76% of in Scranton, don't you? How many think yes, huh? Okay. So you can see why I had trouble introducing him. You know, he's too much. Meaning he's plenty, he's great. Questions, we have about 10 minutes of questions. Are we speechless? No. Yeah,
please. Do you need some mic or no? It's okay.
Back up. You talked about culture and you referenced several literary giants. And my question is this: Italy has a very long tradition, literary and now cinematic tradition, of rendering corruption transparent, but not only corruption in the way that it's executed, also the mentality of corruption. And my question is this: I think that when authors write and when directors make films with this in mind, they do it with a purpose and also with a certain background and preparation. And my question is, in your work against corruption and the mentality of corruption, which you have spoken about very eloquently today, do you draw inspiration from any of these documents, any of these texts, both fiction and nonfiction?
But when we speak about corruption, we speak about two different realities. Corruption can be considered a list of single act of corruption, a list of single act of violation of law. But I have no special fear for normal criminals, and no special fear for many single corrupted persons. I fear when the criminality becomes a system, when corruption becomes a system of corruption. Because when it becomes a system, we have no reaction of people. Because the single act is considered just a crime. But when it's inside a system, everybody does so. And so we have just a corruption on all the different level of life. What we need is to send the message that probably corruption, the single act of corruption, probably is convenient for somebody. But system of corruption is not convenient for everybody. And when it becomes system of corruption, you have corrupted just the rules of civil convivence. And speaking about that, I wish to speak about the difference between the old and the new mafia. Until now, I have spoken about the old mafia. The old mafia is traditionally connected, bounded to Sicily, China, Russia, Islam, and there's an adjective of that identity. But now we have the new mafia. The new mafia doesn't pervert single identity values. The new mafia does pervert global values. Global values. The new mafia pervert global values like freedom without rules, competition transformed into monopoly, like development transformed only in richness. The new mafioso needs to speak about a freedom without rules. Needs to speak about a competition that is necessary to build monopoly. Because the mafiosi, they don't want to have rules about the use of freedom. They are the most important defensor of the freedom. I mean, without rules. That means that the rule of the strength, the rule of the power, the rule of the money. The second, they try to build monopole. They have fear for free market system. And the third, they try to let people imagine that you are developed if you are rich. You know, there is a great difference between development and richness. Because richness is how much do you have, and development is how do you use what you have. I can be poor, but developed, if I use correctly the few things I have. I can be rich, but underdeveloped, if I don't use correctly the richness I have. May I give you some example of a very rich person underdeveloped? A very rich person underdeveloped is a mafia boss. He's very rich, but he does not live in harmony with the richness he has. Changing just example. In my opinion, we have in Italy a politician that is really rich, but really rich, but underdeveloped. Berlusconi is so rich, but so underdeveloped. So we need to send the message that we need harmony. The harmony in respecting human rights is just the best way to fight against corruption. What is the danger today? Another time, the Pope Francis speaks clearly about that. We have transformed the money into our God. When God is the money, people producing things, they have no value. People teaching in university, they have no value. People working in the industries, they have no value. When the money has become God, we destroy the human convivence and we promote corruption. When the money is God, there is no difference between the house of a mafia boss in Corleone and the office of businessmen in Frankfurt. No difference when the money is the super God. So we need just to understand that we have to fight against the idolatry of the money. I am not speaking against the money. I need the money, so I cannot speak. I desire money. So I cannot speak about something that I desire. It's not a problem. I'm not against the money. I am against the culture considering the money the most relevant element in civil society and civil convivence. So the inspiration about that is inspiration of people who says that corruption is not convenient. Look at what happens today in Italy. We have discovered that corruption is not convenient. It's not convenient. Because do not pay taxes. Imagine there was a politician in Italy who said that it is correct not to pay taxes. Another one who said Minister of Infrastructures, it means public works in Italy, the most important politician having responsibility for public works in Italy, who said that in name of business can be necessary to live together with the mafia. Understand what that means? Because if God is money, all the ethical rules, they have no value. So I think that the role against the system of corruption, we need the second wheel. The second wheel of the cart, the school, the church, the businessman, the civil society, the journalist. We need just another dimension of the style of life.
Sono di
Caltanissetta.
Ho una curiosità. Perché Andreotti non è stato punito?
But the question is why Andreotti was not condemned. I have to say that I don't take care about the process. I don't speak about process. I don't speak about process because I think that we need to give an ethical statement, a political statement, a moral statement, not a legal statement. I have to say that Andreotti has been recognized protecting the mafia boss until 1980. But he was not condemned, as the court and recognized that he was responsible. But he was not condemned because he passed more than 15 years. So he is recognized responsible, but is not condemned for the so-called prescrizione. I don't know what is the right name in English. Prescrizione, when after 10 years, you cannot be condemned. Okay, exactly. So he's recognized responsible, but not condemned. But I don't think that we have to speak about the process. I have a great respect for the judges. I have great respect for the prosecutors, but I'm not a prosecutor. I have to respect the prosecutor condemning me if I keep at home an illegal migrant. So that I respect. This is the law. But I wish that somebody said that probably Orlando had done something illegal but correct. In name of human rights. In name of human rights. I respect the law. It's no problem. I know that what I risk. It's not a problem. May I tell you, I consider a wonderful hero, a wonderful person, a man who has been for many, many years in prison. He's my political model. I have a political model that has been in prison for many years. The name is Nelson Mandela. May I speak positively of Nelson Mandela? But he was condemned. I respect the condemnation. Here inside, everybody loves a man who was arrested for 8 months by the British court, by the civil British court, Gandhi. May I speak positively of Gandhi? And the most relevant person in my life, 2,000 years ago, was condemned to death penalty. Jesus Christ. May I speak positively of Jesus Christ? I cannot, because he was condemned. Of course, what I don't wish is that Andreotti imagined to be Jesus Christ. So, I think that I have the right to speak positively of a person condemned in the same way to speak negatively about a person who has been absolved. Because I speak about ethic values, not law. May I say that Voltaire was not legally a criminal, but he was ethically a criminal? Because he was a merchant of slaves. So I know that it's difficult to make distinction, but if you don't make this distinction, there's the risk that everybody imagine that the ethic is only the ethic resulting from the statements of the judges. I refuse. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Well, what a way to end our semester. We'll never forget it. Thank you so much.
Sorry, I've seen it. I have a tremendous experience. I've told many of my mistakes.